Greetings to the great Stanley Park Baptist Church family, and welcome to our online service. We are glad to once again bring church to your home. In times like the ones we're living in, it's important to remember that the Church of God is not paralyzed. On the contrary, the church is beautiful and strong, reaching more people than ever. It is touching and inspiring to know that a great number of people join us every week to connect together as the church. We pray and believe that today's message will increase your faith in a sovereign God who is in control of all things. So be strengthened and encouraged, and enjoy this Sunday service. Let's worship our Lord together. Come set your rule and reign in our hearts again. Increase in us, we pray. Unveil why we're made. Come set our hearts ablaze with hope, like wildfire in our very souls. Holy Spirit, come invade us now.
Give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. You give life. You are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. And it's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. Shout your praise. Our hearts will cry. These bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry. These bones will sing. Great. Shout your praise. Our hearts will cry. These bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. And all the earth will shout your praise. And our hearts will cry. These bones will sing. Great. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. Great are you, Lord. Oh, great are you,
upon the waters, the great unknown, where feet may fail, and there I find you in the mystery, in oceans deep, my faith will stand.
To face these circumstances that are attacking us. We do not know what to do, but our eyes are on you. We stand here before you, Holy Spirit, asking you for guidance and wisdom during this time. Show us your will and what we should do. You say that we are not to be afraid or discouraged because of these dark times, for the battle is not ours, but it's yours, God. All you ask us to do is stand firm and keep our position in you, and we will see the deliverance that you will give us. Again, you tell us, do not be afraid, do not be discouraged, because you, Lord, will be with us. Because of this, we fall on our face before you, and we worship you, our God. We have faith in you, and you will hold us up. Our heart sings to you, and we praise you for the splendor of your holiness. We will give thanks to you, Lord, for your love endures forever. During this time of waiting, we will remember what you have done in the past, where you have fought for us and have provided our needs well beyond what we could ever imagine or think. Lord, we know you will be victorious, and through you, we rest completely. Thank you for your amazing love, care, and protection over us. We ask this all in the precious name, holy name of Jesus. Amen.
Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call. Deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters in the breath.
Hi everyone, it's Pastor Peter with Stanley Burke. How are all of our Bible Town people doing this week? We pray you're doing well and we hope you're getting to spend time with Jesus every day. Now I do have a very special devotional ready for all of you today, but it's one of those days where I've got to be on the lookout for the mailman who's supposed to drop off some packages for me again. So in the meantime, I'm going to get you, Stanley Burke, to watch over the kids. Do you think you can do that? Oh, yeah, yeah. I'm sure you guys are going to have lots of fun together, okay? So I'll be back in a moment, okay? Mm-hmm. Okay, cool. See ya.
Hello.
Wow, I can't believe what I'm seeing and hearing. Stanley Burke, did you play another song for the kids?
Uh-huh.
Wow, let me get rid of these boxes. I want to hear all about this. What did he play for you guys? Stanley Burke, why don't you put your violin away? Was it good? Was it another good song? What did you play, Stanley Burke? It is well with my soul. Wow, what an amazing hymn. It's actually one of my favorite hymns, and it's totally related to today's devotional. I just can't believe these coincidences. It's almost like it's all planned. Anyways, today's devotional is actually taken from Philippians chapter 4, verses 11 to 13, in which Paul writes, "I have learned to be content no matter what happens to me. I know what it's like not to have what I need. And I also know what it's like to have more than I need. I have learned the secret of being content no matter what happens. I am content whether I am well fed or hungry. I am content whether I have more than enough or not enough. I can do everything by the power of Christ because He gives me strength." See, just like the words of the song, "It is well with my soul," that Stanley Burke just played for you, Paul talks about how he is content and at peace no matter what situation he is in, even when things are really good or really bad. He knows that no matter what happens, he belongs to Jesus. Paul knows that by trusting in Jesus, he will be given the strength to endure anything that might happen to him, and that makes him content, and it gives him peace in his mind, in his heart, and in his soul. If we belong to Jesus and trust in Him for the forgiveness of our sin, we too can have this peace in our souls, and we don't have to worry or be scared of anything that we might be going through. Also, for my little ones, for our Bible Town people, if you can go on the internet with the help of your mom or dad, I would highly recommend that you look up the lyrics to the song, "It Is Well With My Soul." And maybe you can actually practice singing it together to Stanley Burke's violin. Pay attention to the words and see how they point us to Jesus and the contentment, the peace that we can find in Him, no matter what we might be going through. Well, Stanley Burke, that was amazing. I'm so glad you played that song. And I'm so glad that we got to look at this devotional, this passage today. I mean, Paul really knew what it meant to have peace, no matter what situation he was in. And so, you know what? Why don't we now pray together and ask for that peace in Jesus' name, why don't we talk to our Heavenly Father and ask Him to give us this true contentment, to make it well with our souls, okay? So let's bow our heads, let's bring our hands together, and let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank You so much for Your peace, the peace that You give us through Your love, through the work of Jesus Christ on the cross and His rising from the dead, and the peace that we sense daily through the presence of the Holy Spirit who lives in us. Lord, help us to remember every day that when we follow Jesus, that we can also know Your peace and that it can be well with our soul every moment of our lives, because we know that no matter what we can go through or will go through, we are Yours. Lord, I pray for all of our Bible Town people right now. I pray that they would learn about this peace. I pray that they would learn more about Jesus every day and that they would live rightly. I pray that they would come to know Him as their Lord and Savior. Lord, I pray that You would bless them this coming week. And I pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Well, that was awesome. I can't believe Stanley Bark played another song for you. He really is a talented dog. And you know what? It's always awesome to see all of you every week. And I pray that you have an awesome week. And we'll see you next Sunday, okay? God bless. Bye-bye.
Thank you. hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name. We worship and adore you today. Lord, we thank you for the hope that you bestow, for the peace that you have brought, for the love you have so freely and lavishly poured out upon us in Christ. Lord, I thank you for the call, the privilege, and the power of prayer that we can join together today in the matchless name of Jesus Christ, your Son and our Savior, whose blood was poured out to pay the penalty for our sin on the cross in full. Lord, thank you that through faith in him who died and 3 days later rose victorious from the grave, that we are forgiven and can approach you today without fear of condemnation as your children, known and so loved by you. Thank you for Jesus, Lord. We approach you today with reverent confidence, knowing that you know everything, Father, that you are mighty to save and mighty to answer our prayers in perfect accordance with your perfect will. And so, Lord, I pray for this world, God, that you would deliver us from evil and specifically from the COVID-19 virus. Lord, we continue to pray for healing for those who are sick, for protection for those who are vulnerable and those working on the front lines. We pray for wisdom for our doctors, our hospital staff, and long-term care workers. Father God, you know and alone are able to meet every one of our needs. There's nothing beyond you, Lord. For the biggest need in this world, from that to the smallest need in our lives, you know it all, Lord. You know the needs in our families, indeed in our church family. And Father God, you know that there are many in our midst too who are hurting, who are sick. Lord God, I pray you pour out your healing and comforting power and presence. Father, I pray you'd also pour your peace and comfort and healing upon those mourning the recent loss of loved ones today. Lord God, may they know the strength of your presence and be reminded of the living hope that we have in Christ. Lord God, sustain them this day and in the days to come by your all-sufficient grace and the comfort that only you can bring. Father, today I pray for all of our missionaries serving with CBM and Pioneers throughout the world. Lord, we thank you for each of them and their families and pray your provision, your hedge of protection over them through these especially trying times right now. Lord God, I pray you would strengthen and sustain them by your grace. Continue to empower them by your Holy Spirit in the ministry of the gospel that you have called them to, as today they continue to minister for your name's sake. Lord, I pray for the men and women in offices of government who need you and the influence of your Holy Spirit more than ever before. So Lord, I pray your influence would be known and experienced here in Canada at every level of government. May there be a revival in this nation of righteousness and truth that will defeat the powers of evil and Satan and turn people's hearts to you, God, by the power of your Holy Spirit. And now, this morning, I pray that you would speak to us powerfully through your word, that we would be quick to listen to what you have to say through the preaching of your word, God, and by the power of your Holy Spirit, comforting us and confronting us, challenging us and changing us for our good and ultimately for your glory. So, Lord, I pray that everything that is said and done be effective to accomplish what you have in store for us today. Again, for our good and for the sake of your kingdom and your glory forever and ever. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Good morning and welcome once again to our service of worship. I pray this finds you doing well and keeping cool with the crazy heat that we've been getting out there this last little while. A children's catechism class was learning the Apostles' Creed. A few of the children had been assigned a specific sentence to memorize and repeat. So the first boy stood up and he said, I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. Then he sat down. The second little girl then stood up and she said, I believe in Jesus Christ, his only son. And then she sat down. And then there was a long, awkward silence. The kids were looking around, and finally the first boy stood up and he said, Teacher, what should we do? The boy who believes in the Holy Spirit isn't here. As cute as that story is, tragically, I'm afraid there's truth to it in the church in North America today. Though many in the church claim to believe in and be filled by the Holy Spirit, you would never know that by looking at their lives. Pastor and author Francis Chan puts it this way in his book, Forgotten God, Our Tragic Neglect of the Holy Spirit. He writes this, If I were Satan and my ultimate goal was to thwart God's kingdom and purposes, one of my main strategies would be to get churchgoers to ignore the Holy Spirit. The degree to which this has happened is directly connected to the dissatisfaction most of us feel with and in the church. We understand something very important is missing. I believe that this missing something is actually a missing someone, namely the Holy Spirit. Without him, people operate in their own strength and only accomplish human-sized results. The world is not moved by love or actions that are of a human creation. And the church is not empowered to live differently from any other gathering of people without the Holy Spirit. But when believers live in the power of the Holy Spirit, the evidence in their lives is supernatural. The church cannot help but be different, and the world cannot help but notice. And that's exactly what happened at Pentecost, which we just celebrated a few weeks ago. When God poured out the Holy Spirit into the hearts of his disciples, the evidence in their lives was supernatural. Everyone around could not help but notice Jesus' disciples, these ordinary Galileans, miraculously declaring the praises of God in the languages of people from every nation under heaven, so that everybody could hear and understand the truth about God. And then Peter, empowered by the Holy Spirit, explains this miracle and preaches the gospel for the first time. And 3,000 people, 3,000 are saved. They repent of their sins. They turn in faith to Jesus Christ for forgiveness. And they're baptized. Wow. The aim of the Holy Spirit, his overarching purpose in all that he does is ultimately to bring glory to God. How? Primarily by empowering our worship, empowering our witness, empowering our words, empowering our works. It's his power at work. More than anything and more than ever, we, the church, need to experience the power of the Holy Spirit in our lives. Lives of Spirit-empowered worship and Spirit-empowered witness to Christ, and all for the glory of God. So this morning, I want to ask this question. Where does God's power flow? In what kind of environment will we see God's power at work? Because I think there's some basic and essential principles in Acts chapter 3 that we need to recognize and embrace if we expect to see God's power at work. In the closing verses of Acts chapter 2, we read this, verse 43. Everyone was filled with awe, and many wonders and miraculous signs were done by the apostles. Look at that again. Everyone was filled with awe, and many wonders and miraculous signs were done by the apostles. Now, Acts 3 explains one of those many wonders and miraculous signs. Now, the Holy Spirit is not named here specifically in chapter 3, but he is most certainly at work in and through Peter and John, as we're going to see in our passage this morning. So I would invite you at home to turn with me in your Bibles to Acts chapter 3, and I will be reading verses 1 to 10 from the New International Version. Acts chapter 3, verses 1 to 10. One day, Peter and John were going up to the temple at the time of prayer, at 3 in the afternoon. Now, a man crippled from birth was being carried to the temple gate called Beautiful, where he was put every day to beg from those going into the temple courts. When he saw Peter and John about to enter, he asked them for money. Peter looked straight at him, as did John. Then Peter said, "Look at us." So the man gave them his attention, expecting to get something from them. Then Peter said, "Silver or gold I do not have, but what I have I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, walk." Taking him by the right hand, he helped him up, and instantly the man's feet and ankles became strong. He jumped to his feet and began to walk. Then he went with them into the temple courts, walking and jumping and praising God. When all the people saw him walking and praising God, they recognized him as the same man who used to sit begging at the temple gate called Beautiful, and they were filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened to him. May the Lord add his blessing to the reading of his word today. So, where is God's power at work? Well, here in this passage in Acts 3, we see that God's power is at work in his temple through faith in Jesus' name for the glory of God. In, through, and for. So we're going to start with that first principle, that God's power is at work in his temple. Now let me explain what I mean by that. In verse 1, we read that Peter and John are on their way to the temple for afternoon prayers, which took place at 3 in the afternoon. Many Jewish Christians continued to attend the temple services for some time after the church was formed. It was very common during this time of transition. Verse 2 tells us that a man crippled from birth was being carried to the temple gate called Beautiful, where he was put every day to beg from those going into the temple courts. The gate called Beautiful was one of 9 gates surrounding the temple. And it was one of the best spots for beggars to beg for money, because not only did huge crowds go to the temple every day, but they also came with money in hand, ready to give in hopes of impressing God with their piety and their faith. Why? Because the temple was God's house on earth. It was the place of worship. It held the Holy of Holies, the most holy place. Historically, it's where God's power and presence dwelt on earth. So if you wanted to meet with God, you'd go to the temple. The thing is, God had moved out. His presence didn't dwell in the temple anymore. On the cross, when Jesus said, "It is finished," and gave up his spirit and died to pay for the sins of humanity once and for all time. At that very moment, the Bible records that the curtain in the temple, which for centuries had separated people from God's presence, it was torn in two from top to bottom. God's holy presence would no longer be separated in seclusion. God's presence on earth was moving out of the temple and into a new temple. Actually, temples, to be more precise, as his Holy Spirit would now indwell the hearts of all those who repent of their sins and turn in faith to his Son, Jesus Christ, for forgiveness. That's what happens when we are born again of the Holy Spirit. Through faith in Jesus, we, his followers, become the temples of the Holy Spirit. We are the new dwelling place of God on earth. My friends, we need to hear this today. We need to be reminded of this crucial truth, because sadly, we quickly forget, don't we? Which is why the Apostle Paul repeatedly questions the Corinthians on this, saying, Don't you know that you yourselves are God's temple and that God's Spirit lives in you? 1 Corinthians 3:16, he says that. And then he repeats it three chapters later. He says, do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you've received from God? 1 Corinthians 6:19. See, that's what I mean when I say God's power is at work in his temple. Temples, plural. Through faith in Jesus Christ, our hearts become sanctuaries, temples of his Holy Spirit, where God's presence now dwells on earth. Though this crippled man had sat at the gates of the temple for years, for the first time that day, he experiences the power of God's presence, not flowing down and out of the doors of the temple, but walking up the stairs to the temple in Peter and John, who were now themselves the temples of the Holy Spirit. Now look at verse 4. When the man sees them coming, he asks them for money. And when he did that, verse 4 says, Peter looked straight at him, as did John. See, most people would have nothing to do with this guy. The Jews believe that for a person to be afflicted like this, they or their parents must have committed some serious sin, because this was clearly the punishment of God. But Peter looked straight at him. And the word translated look straight is the Greek word atenzio, which is the same word used to describe the way the disciples intensely stared at Jesus as he ascended into heaven out of their sight in Acts 1. It's this unflinching gaze. They were completely focused on this man whom they'd very likely passed by many times before. So why the sudden focus on him now? Because being led by the Holy Spirit, they were now seeing through God's eyes. And so they couldn't help but focus on this poor man who needed what they had to give. But it wasn't their spare change he needed. He needed spirit change. He needed help. He needed hope. He needed freedom. He needed Christ. And as we're going to see, Peter reaches out and heals this man point blank because God's power works in and through his followers, his temples filled with the Holy Spirit. Which means that wherever we go, God's power should flow. As Paul writes in 2 Corinthians 3:17, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And that is exactly what this man is given. My friends, if it's true that our bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit, then shouldn't our lives look radically different from the lives of people who do not have the Holy Spirit of God living in them? So then, how come a lot of times they don't? How come it sometimes seems like we don't really believe that? Do we really believe that our God is able to do immeasurably more than all we can ask or imagine according to his power at work within us? Dear Lord, increase our faith and reliance upon you, upon your Holy Spirit. God's power is at work in his temples, number two, through faith in Jesus Christ. So God's power is at work in his temples through faith in Jesus' name. That's what we see here. Now, to be clear, we're not talking about the faith of the crippled man, because, well, that was non-existent. Even though we read in verse 5 that the crippled man expected to get something, he was basically just hoping for a little pocket change. It was Peter's faith at work here. He says in verse 6, silver or gold I do not have, but what I have I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, walk. Jesus Christ of Nazareth was the common designation for Jesus during his earthly ministry. In the name of means by virtue of Christ's character, authority, and power. So to do something in the name of Jesus Christ is to act consistent with his will. To do what he would do if he were here, to act in his authority by his power. Matthew 28:18, Jesus said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me." My friends, may we be reminded that the ultimate authority in the universe belongs to Jesus Christ, through whom it was created. Unparalleled authority to heal and restore, to release and deliver, authority to advance God's kingdom. And he has invested that authority in his disciples and in turn his church in order to accomplish his purposes on earth. Peter had often seen Jesus heal. Well, now, through faith in Jesus' name, on Jesus' behalf, with the power and authority given to him, Peter commands this man to walk. You notice that? He doesn't stop to pray for the man first. By faith, he simply claims the authority and power available in the name of Jesus and tells this man to walk. And then we read in verse 7 that instantly, the man's feet and ankles became strong. He jumped to his feet and began to walk. Now, the words translated feet and ankles here are medical terms found nowhere else in Scripture that Luke uses to emphasize the significance, the immediacy, and the fullness of this miracle. You just think about the long, slow process that a toddler goes through in learning how to walk. And when you think about that, you realize just how amazing it is that this man, who had never taken a step in his entire life, is immediately not only able to walk, but to run and leap into the air for joy, as we read in verse 8. It is through faith in Jesus' name that Peter, led and empowered by the Holy Spirit, reaches out and heals this man. Not for a second did Peter hesitate or doubt if it would happen, because it was the Holy Spirit directing him to do this. So Peter counted on the fact that God was going to heal this man. So it raises a question. What about miraculous healings today? Does God still do this? Well, according to God's word, I believe that God can heal any person of anything in any way, in any place, at any time he wants, by his power and grace, according to his sovereign purposes, full stop. And there are many verses in Scripture that instruct us to ask God to heal us physically, and he often does exactly that. Many of us know and can attest to his healing work in our lives. James 5 is a good example, where we're told if anyone is sick, to have the elders come together and pray, anointing the sick person with oil. God will hear the prayer of faith and can heal the sick person completely. We need to take God at his word. But the truth is, God does not always promise to heal in this way. There are many examples in Scripture where he chooses not to heal. Even those who are strong in the faith, like the Apostle Paul, who pleaded with God to remove the thorn in his flesh, but he didn't. Instead, God pours out his all-sufficient grace and teaches that his power is made perfect in our weakness. See, there's an important purpose and pattern of God's miraculous healing we see here in Acts 3 and throughout the rest of the book. And I think it gives us a framework, a checklist, against which we need to test any so-called miraculous healing today. Miraculous healing that fits the biblical pattern in Acts has these criteria. It's always instant and complete. It's not gradual. It's always a matter of God's sovereign choice. Again, it's God directing Peter to do this through the Holy Spirit. It's always done in the name and authority of Jesus Christ, and it is always ultimately for the glory of God. So I think it's important that we exercise wisdom and be really careful about faith healers and healing ministries today, which often do not match these criteria. What's interesting is that in the book of Acts, the people who received miraculous physical healing, including this crippled man here, were all unbelievers. The point being that the ultimate purpose of God pouring out his power in Acts isn't for physical healing alone. Like all the miracles and wonders God performs, miraculous healing is a sign, and a sign points to something. And John explains the purpose of all of Jesus' miraculous signs and of the gospel itself in John 20, verse 30. He writes, "Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book," verse 31, "but these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name." And it's the exact same purpose here. God's miraculous work of healing in the book of Acts is never simply to relieve our pain for our good, but ultimately to reveal God's power for his glory. God's healing powers is not just meant to restore bodies, but ultimately to redeem souls through faith in Jesus. It's not to soothe believers' pain, but to save unbelievers in Jesus' name through the proclamation of the gospel. The ultimate picture and purpose of physical healing in Scripture is spiritual healing, salvation in Jesus' name, both for those who experience the healing and for those who witness it, as we're going to see in part two of this chapter in a few weeks. The end result of this miracle is that 2,000 more people believe and are saved by faith in Jesus to the glory of God. See, it's always about the glory of God. Which brings us to that last principle. God's power is at work in his temples through faith in Jesus' name for the glory of God. God moved in power here in Acts 3 and healed this lame man in order that he would be glorified. Being led by the Spirit, Peter and John could boldly claim the authority of Jesus' name because this miracle was ultimately going to bring glory to God. In verse 8, we read that the crippled man jumped to his feet and began to walk. Then he went with them into the temple courts, walking and jumping and what does it say? Praising God, verse 8. His first words and actions were exuberant praise and thanksgiving to God. Nobody had to tell him to go to the temple. Nobody told him he should really thank God. No. He knew he had to. He couldn't help but praise God. It's the same thing that happened at Pentecost, isn't it? See, wherever the Holy Spirit is at work pouring out his power, God is glorified. How? Well, again, by empowering our worship and empowering our witness as his followers. It seems like the most genuine act of worship that likely took place in the temple courts that day was this man's exuberant shouts of praise and thanksgiving to God. And notice his worship was also a witness, a testimony to everyone around. Verse 9, when all the people saw him walking and praising God, they recognized him as the same man who used to sit begging at the temple gate called Beautiful, and they were filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened to him. This man was living proof that a miracle had taken place. But the miracle was only a sign. His healing was like God's introduction. His way of getting people's attention in preparation for Peter's second gospel sermon. See, the stage was now set for Peter to preach Christ again, which we're going to look at in part two. So, to be continued. Where does God's power flow? Where will we see it at work? God's power is at work in and through his disciples. We are now the temples of his Holy Spirit on earth. Through faith in Jesus' name, that is by the power and authority of Christ, and all to the praise and glory of God. My friends, may Stanley Park Baptist Church be that kind of environment. And I'm not talking about our church building. I'm talking about you and I as members of the body of Christ on earth, both collectively when we are able to get together again, yes, but also individually as individual followers of Christ. wherever we set foot this week, may it be in submission to and in step with the Holy Spirit who lives in the temple of our hearts, my friends. May we believe in and be filled by and rely upon Him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we can ask or imagine, according to His power that is at work within us, producing lives of Spirit-empowered worship and Spirit-empowered witness through faith in Jesus' name and by His authority to the glory of God the Father. My friends, as followers of Jesus Christ, wherever we go, may God's power flow. In Jesus' name, amen.
The same power that conquered the grave lives in me.
Now receive the Lord's blessing from Ephesians 3, verses 20 and 21. Now to Him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or can imagine, according to His power, may His power at work within us bring Him glory in the church, in Jesus Christ through all generations, forever and ever. Now to Him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or can imagine, according to His power, may His power at work within us bring Him glory in the church, in Jesus Christ through all generations, forever and ever. May His power at work within us bring Him glory in the church, in Jesus Christ through all generations, forever and ever.